Welcome, fellow citizens from a galaxy far, far away. In this episode on the Jedi Arms Dealer channel, we're going to cover a very lengthy build that is, again, another collaboration by Master Jeff Chong and Master Maltais, aka the Jedi Arms Dealer. And this build has been in the works for quite a while. I think Jeff shipped me this saber, just over 2 years ago. And so since then, you know, we've built Daria's Luke Skywalker saber, a couple of thermal detonators. And so this saber right here has actually been in the works build time for probably a year and a few months. As far as me actually getting to, you know, design everything and work on it. And so with that said, this is going to be a really long video again. So you guys, it's going to be a marathon one. So sit back, relax. Bust out your snacks and hang in for the long ride, because it's gonna be a while. We've got so much to go over on the saber. Sometimes I don't even really quite know where to start. Of course, I like to always start with a little bit of history. And so when Jeff shipped me this saber, we were going for, you know, maybe one of the craziest, most innovative Korbanth LS6 Luke Skywalker sabers we could possibly do. And so, you know, I love working with Jeff because he always has like some of the most amazing ideas for these sabers that, you know, we build. And so this one's no exception at all. We talked about, you know, of course, making it a fully removable chassis, making everything work on it, like, you know, the lights blinking in the control box. And with the fully removable chassis, it comes with a lot of challenges trying to remove this control box and then reattach it and have everything work. So he also wanted USB in-hilt recharge and an in-hilt battery. So this is not a removable battery. And then, as usual, this stand is, you know, more or less a surprise. Kind of the history on this stand is something I sort of came up with in the last few months. We removed a couple of satellite dishes off the top of our house that were here from the previous residence. And so this stand right here is actually the shell left over from the waveguide box that is like out on the end of the antenna. And so, you know, you crack it open and there's all these waveguides on the other half of it. And so I was like, you know what? I bet I could turn that into a crazy looking lightsaber stand. So this is, it's all metal too, like all around here. I'm sure you guys have seen these on the end of satellite dishes. So I love taking like old stuff and, you know, refurbishing it and turning it into something new. So this lightsaber stand took some time, but we got it right and I'm really happy with it. The other thing that we talked about is I was like, hey, Jeff, how do you feel about maybe doing like a world's first as far as swappable crystals go? It ended up being 9 different color crystals that you can swap in and out of this crystal chamber. And because it's such a tiny space to work with inside this saber, the crystals actually, when they're removed magnetically, they actually move out of the way of the SD card access and the USB port access on the Profi. So this bought us like probably another, well, I mean, I had to shave each crystal to exactly 16.5 millimeters. So it's almost like a half an inch of space that we were able to buy once you remove the crystal and get in here. So let's see. Right out of the box, Jeff, this is of course gonna be your operating manual for this. We got a lot of ground to cover. So let's go ahead and dive in. And so I kind of figured out the issue where when the crystal chamber, you can see a little bit of light through there, right? And that's because, you know, this is screwed in and this puts pressure on this part of the saber. And when you reveal it like this, because of course this is the Korbanth LS6. You reveal it like this and right now you see there's no crystal in there. And so right there is your Profi USB access and SD card access underneath with tweezers. And then I'll get into how to access the USB once we connect this via bench mode on the USB interface online, which is pretty cool. So I'm gonna do like this in different sections. One of the sections will be me showing off that aspect of the saber. But right now, the saber has like a white flickering LED inside the front of it, and that's kind of what you're seeing glowing and flickering through the acrylic that was wrapped around the profi board. And again, I used kind of minimal acrylic in this build, but I love using acrylic because how the light bounces through here. It's kind of mixed. The light in the crystal chamber is mixed with like an accent light that's in the rear of this. And so I love how all the colors kind of mix together and the animations and everything. So, but what I discovered, Jeff, is font one, I programmed it so that the lights are out in both the crystal chamber and the accent LEDs. So let's like say pretend we have to insert a crystal in here to get this saber to actually do anything. And so what you would do is set the saber down, okay, in reveal mode. And then I am gonna send you two pairs of these tweezers right here. I actually broke a pair of these, and so I'm sending you two just in case. The other ones were just like this, and I don't know why. I painted it with like silver paint, trying to make it look like Luke Skywalker's tool in the cave scene. And so I'm gonna send you two of them just in case. But I think maybe the paint did something to the plastic on these, but these two have been working great. So what I like to do is grab the crystal, right, with your tweezers, just like this. And these are all magnetic, by the way. So if I let go of that, and if I were to flip this stand upside down or it gets bumped, these crystals will not move. They're all attached. These are steel bases on each of the crystals. And the crystals are neodymium magnets that are in the acrylic and glued in here so that they don't move around. So to grab one, just grab it like this. And then you're just going to kind of hold it up into the crystal chamber, let go of it. And then once it kind of catches, then you just sort of push it into place like that. All right. So there are the crystals inserted. So the other cool thing about this saber is that I am using the Force Sync app, and I can control it with the Force Sync app. So I'll kind of be going back and forth between the buttons and the Force Sync app while we do this. So let's go ahead and go to font number two, which is gonna be the same font. This is the Luke Skywalker cave scene font. And so what we're gonna do is go from font one to font two, and then you'll see it come to life. Okay. And basically what's happening right now is when you switch between fonts, every single font is showing you the color crystal that it wants. So right now you've got four, I think these are the 1515 super tiny LED strips in there. There's four of them that are, they're showing you, insert the crystal in that direction. And so it wants us to insert a green crystal. So that's what we've done. So when we fire it up, another thing Jeff and I talked about was, Jeff was concerned that the electric motor in here that spins the crystal chamber would wear down the battery too quickly. And so I messed with the program, and I actually came up with a way to where with the Profi, the crystal does not spin when you fire it up, but then when you hit blaster or lock up or clash, when it's bumped, the crystal does spin. So every fourth font, Jeff, is the opposite. So say fonts 1, 2, 3, it doesn't spin on ignition, but it spins momentarily when you clash or blaster or lock up. Then when you get to font 4, then it's going to spin all the time. So, every fourth font, it does that to save on battery. Not that the electric motor even uses that much electricity, but I thought that was kind of a cool thing to sort of kind of go back and forth between the two styles of programming. So let's go ahead and fire this up, and we'll see what happens in the crystal chamber. So right now you see that the crystal's stationary, okay? And then we zoom in, and then it shows all of your blaster effects. So what's cool about what FET263 has done on his website is for every channel you set up for these, and these are set up on subblades, by the way, but for every subblade or channel you set up for these, it does effects for everything. Power up, power down, blast or clash, lock up, it's just crazy. So when we use blaster, you'll see the crystal momentarily rotates, right? Same with clash. and then lock up. And so basically what we came up with is like the crystal is absorbing, it's absorbing the lockup energy every time it gets hit with something. Okay? And power down. And you can see the power down cooldown effects and everything changes. There's also an accent LED inside, like a round accent LED, pixel accent LED, and hopefully I can get these, what Jeff and I call the Bombay doors. We've been joking around back and forth about the Bombay doors. Hopefully I can get these open. Let me use the other, you can use the tweezer tool right here to pop these open, because what I've done, and this ended up becoming the power gate in here. And so what I've done is I've added more super strong magnets on this side and this side, shave the inside surfaces of these so that when this closes, one of Jeff's requests is that it eliminates the gap that is normally here on the Korbanth LS6. I mean, there was a good like 16th of an inch gap where you can see into here, and it drove both of us crazy. And so I shaved these surfaces with a Dremel wheel and then literally super glued in. Each of these are individual magnets, super glued them in a row. And so this thing is actually really difficult to get open, you know, so I wanted to make sure that when you're swinging it around, these doors just aren't flying open and stuff. They will not come open unless you pry them open with your fingernail or like that pointed tool I just used. But this ended up becoming the power gate section. We talked about putting the crystal chamber in here, but there was no way, no matter how I did the arrangement, to get the 650. Let's say we move the 650 up into this part of the saber in the upper section here, the grip section, or up here on the body section. There's no way I could get as thick a wires as I wanted back and forth between the profi, because I use my 20 gauge oxygen free copper wires. They're like really thick speaker wires, so that we're getting all the energy we can to this emitter and to the blades, so the blades are nice and bright. I don't like using anything thinner than 22 gauge or 20 gauge in my builds, because I want all of the amps to be going to that NeoPixel blade. So this ended up becoming the energy gate because it made sense to put the battery in this section. So when we fire it up, this also has its own, you know, power up clash and all kinds of different effects. See how that cycles up and then it just goes like into like a fast rotating red. Same with clash. Same with, blaster. Clash. And then lock up. So what's crazy about what they've set up on OS6 and in OS7 coming up, is that you can go in with the USB program and change all of the colors of these different things, how it reacts. We can make that clash do white, any color you want, and it'll memorize those things. So there is the power gate section. And then it cycles down. Okay? And you see we have no light bleeding through, which that was not easy to do, but we got it. So, back into reveal mode and going through the crystal chamber. So when we cycle through the fonts, I'm just gonna, basically what I set up, Jeff, is you have 13 original trilogy fonts on, 13 kind of Luke Skywalker fonts. The last two are like, you know, some of the newer stuff that's come out. But for the most part, most of them are original trilogy. So as we cycle through, actually, let me just use the ForceSync app here real quick. But as we cycle through, as the colors change, now right now we're gonna be mostly green because it's all, you know, Luke Skywalker, Return of the Jedi stuff. But as we cycle through and the colors change, we're gonna swap out the crystals to the different colors, because the crystal chamber is gonna ask us for, or the lightsaber itself, is gonna ask us for a different color that the blade will ignite to. So the crystal chamber is always mirrored to the blade as far as when it's in idle mode like this. So if it's green, it's gonna be a green blade. If it's red, it's gonna be a red blade, and so on. Hence, all the crystals here. So let's go ahead and advance to the next font.
I'm Luke Skywalker.
We'll fire it up. And so this is another one where the crystal is stationary. And so then we have Clash. You can see it's reacting to everything. Blaster. Force sounds. And then lock up. And now the crystal's absorbing the energy. We have tip drag. And then there's theme music in every single font. And then deactivate. And then, of course, we can kill the music. All right, next font.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Fire it up. And again, no rotation on this font. We have clash. Blaster. Force. Lock up. Crystals again rotating. And drag and shut down. Next font. This is speeder bike. And so now you can see it's asking for a different crystal. And so what we're gonna do is grab our tweezers and we're gonna pluck this crystal out of here like so. And you can grab like the little holes on the sides and pull it out magnetically. All right, there she is. Put her back where she belongs, right? So now we're doing more of kind of like an orange color now that we're in speeder bike. And so we can grab this crystal here and put it up into place. All right. Crystal is now installed. It's ready for speeder bike mode. Here we go. So now you can see we're on the font that actually has the crystal rotate all the time. And so when we go into clash, you'll see the crystal pause. So it's opposite of what it was doing before. Okay. Blaster. Force. And then lock up, you'll see the crystal freezes. Drag. All right. And shut down. All right, next font.
It is pointless to resist.
So yeah, now we're fighting Vader. Let's get in here and take out our orange crystal. Put it into place. Grab our red crystal. Insert. And now we're in Vader mode. So, like, I was kind of thinking of what would be a cool idea for the story on this saber, and Jeff has done an amazing, beautiful job of weathering this saber. I mean, it looks so legit. He's an amazing weatherer. So it looks great. I love it. I wish he'd actually do mine, but so the kind of the background story on this, let's say this was Luke Skywalker's saber, you know, after Return of the Jedi. It's getting a little beat up, it's getting used. Somehow he was able to fly all over the galaxy and collect other Jedi and Sith's crystals, right, that are no longer around. Of course, he ended up with Vader's red crystal. Let's say somehow he got a hold of Mace Windu's. This is the green crystal, which is rumored to be Qui-Gon's, right, that ended up in Obi-Wan's chest, we think. Pink could be, say, you know, Mara Jade, or then you have blue from, let's say, he pulled it out of his original Graflex, and so on. So then we have clear that will do all the different colors. Then we have a light yellow and a light green. Okay, so there. Somehow he got a hold of everybody's crystals. It's no longer around. I don't know. He used the Force to find their sabers in the wreckage after Order 66 and so on. And so he's got them all. All right, here we go. Vader mode. So you'll see when it powers up, I love how it does that. Thank you, Fit263. It's great stuff, Fernando. So you'll see when you power it up, like the crystal kind of does something crazy with the power up, and then it settles into a red. So again, we've got crystal motionless, so clash, and then it moves. When we clash, everything's reacting. Blaster. Force.
If you will not turn to the dark side, then perhaps she will.
Blaster. lock up. And drag. Alright, shut down. We're on to the next font.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
Another Vader font. Again, motionless crystal. Until we hit clash or blaster. Force.
Don't know the power of the dark side.
I guess Vader likes to repeat stuff.
Give yourself to the dark side.
Alright, lock up. And now we see the crystal absorbing power. Drag. Same. Alright, and power down. Alright, next font.
If you will not turn to the dark side, then perhaps she will.
Alright, so we gotta get the red crystal out of here, right? Because we don't want to be in Sith mode anymore. So we're gonna grab it with our tweezers. Now you can grab it in a couple different places. You've got the holes in here, or you can grab it by the front of it and just kind of flip it out like that. Yeah. And put that back into place. And we're gonna go back into green mode. So here we go. Green crystal's in. And off we go. Luke Skywalker mode again. Clash. I love how the crystal chamber reacts to everything. Lock up. Tip drag. And shut down. All right, next font.
Skywalker ROTJ.
Old school font, right? Been converted to smooth swing. Clash. Blaster.
I will not turn.
Force. Lock up. Course, right? Alright, shut down. Next font.
Welcome back, Skywalker.
Alright, we're back to red.
I have been expecting.
And so, you can decide whether or not it's Sidious or Vader you're back up against. There we go. Crystal back in. In red mode. Back into Sith mode.
The full power of the dark side.
Clash. Blaster. Force. Lock up. And tip drag. Alright, and shut down.
So be it.
And then this is the Sidious.
I'm looking forward to completing your training. In time, you will call me Master.
And so this is the Sidious font that I put together, where it's kind of Sidious versus Luke. So you can either, you know, pretend they're dueling one another, or also, let's say Luke was tempted by the dark side and he actually started training with Sidious. Let's say the story just went horribly wrong. This is what it would look like. All right, here we go. Battle in Sidious.
You will find that it is you who are mistaken. Give in to your anger.
Now, if you guys caught that, but there was a prion on the crystal chamber, and so I activated prions for everything. So if there is a prion sound in that font, you're going to get prion effects on the blade, on the crystal chamber, and on the effects disc that's, you know, the accent that's loaded just behind, you know, this section here. Okay? Clash. Blaster. Force.
Find that it is you who are mistaken.
And Sidious likes to repeat himself too. Here we go. Lock up.
Strike me down before the dark pit, and your journey towards the dark side will be complete.
Tip drag. And shut. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. I love just watching it in this mode without playing. All right. Music off, shut down.
Good.
Next one. And post off, next font.
Are you a Jedi?
I am.
All right, here we are, fast forward into the Mando series. We're going back to green crystal mode. Luke's about to take on some bunch of robots, apparently, right? Robot troopers. There we go. It's in there. And another motionless on the crystal. Clash. Blaster. Force. Lock up. Tip drag. And then also I added some extra audio from the different scenes. So this is like Luke telling Rey. I'm sorry, this is when his X-Wing lands and he comes in and kicks everybody's ass, so.
X-Wing.
I'm thinking of the next font.
Great, we're saved.
All right, next.
Go away!
And so this is the last of your Luke fonts through the series, and then we start going into like experimental fonts after that. So we'll just show this one off real quick. Grumpy uncle, creepy uncle. It's force. Lock up. Chip drag. And shut down. All right, let's go to the next font. So this is my font called Aquaforce, which is kind of like an underwater lightsaber font. Could think of it as Kit Fisto or just like an underwater lightsaber font in general. So this one's got a pretty cool blade effect on it. When I show the, you know, the segment of blade effects once we get there in the different sections of this video. So here we go, fire it up. Here we are underwater with the Kit Fisto green crystal, I guess. Clash, blaster, force, lock up. Tip drag. All right, shut down. Next font. Oh, looks like we need to insert a red crystal. So let's get the green one out of here. Eventually we'll end up with all the colors. Okay. All right, here we go. Blaster, clash, blaster, force, lock up, drag, and shut down. Next. All right, so now we got a purple crystal that needs to be in here. The red one away, get out the purple one. Now this one doesn't have any holes on it. I kind of wanted to make it clean on the steel body of it that sticks to the magnet. So you notice there's no holes right here. So you'll have to grab it kind of by the end of it and pull it out. You can also take these and pull the lip on the inside here, Jeff, to get the crystal out. So again, there's several ways to get it out of here. Now we got a purple crystal. So crystal chamber reacts on power up, clash, blaster, force, lock up, and tip drag, and shut down. Next. So this is my font called X-Wing. And so it looks like we need a red crystal for this one again. Let's come on in here, and red crystal it is for red 5. All right, here we go. Prion sounds. And so this is one where the crystal finally settles into red. Blasters. Force. Lock up. and tip drag. Alright, shut down. Next font.
The Force is strong in my family.
So now we finally have a blue crystal. Let's get the red one out of here. Yep. Take out our blue crystal. There we go. Flash. Blaster. Back up. Tip drag. And shut down. Next.
Lightsaber.
All right, so this is a kind of a funny one that was a freebie from eons ago that I put in here, which is like Yoda. It's called Lightsaber. And yeah, this was just kind of a silly one. So here we go with the clear crystal, because this is a white blade. All right. So you're shaving, right? And you're cutting yourself with Clash.
Looking? Me. Obi-Wan, cut your beard, you must. Your lack of shade disturbing, I find.
That's Blaster. Lock up. Ouch. And drag. Alright. And shut down. Next font.
What a piece of junk.
So can't wait to show off the blade effects on this one for Millennium Falcon or Piece of Junk. Such a cool font. And FET263 has made it so you can do some pretty insane animations on the blade. So we're to a blue blade. Let's get in here. There we go. There's our blue crystal in place. And it takes a while for it to settle in, and there you go. Millennium Falcon rocket blue again. That was Clash. Blasters. Force. Lock up. And drag. And shut down. Next font. Now we have a light blue. And so this is a New Hope training. And so it's kind of like, looks like a rotoscoping blade when it's going. So it looks like that in the crystal chamber as well. Clash. Blaster.
You made a fair one. Screaming about it can't help you.
Such a great font.
That's not wise, upset a Wookiee.
Lock up. Tip drag. And shut down. Alright.
You should be at all around about 0200 hours.
And so this is my kind of 1970s tribute with the same type of font that's remote training. I call it flying blind. So here we go. Stationary crystal. Clashes. Blasters. Lock up. Tip drag. And shut down. We're getting close.
He's no good to me dead.
So I love this. The blade effect on this is another one. If you go to FET263.com, it's going to show you how to do this really insane effect with like FET dropping bombs. So here we go. Yeah. Settles back into blue. Clashes. Blasters. Force. Lock up. Shut down. Next.
Smooth fuzz.
So this is just kind of a funny one I threw together using the stock profi. So when you fire it up, you'll see what I mean. This is a stock profi font, and I just added some fun stuff. Although you have to swing it to hear it, so I will do that later. But basically it has all of the Wilhelm scream sounds. So there's this, which is a compilation of all the Wilhelm screams ever used in Star Wars. And shut down. All right, next.
Serenity.
Okay, so that concludes like going up to all of the fonts, and then we get into the grayscale. I'm not gonna show those because you guys can download all those for free at grayscalefonts.com, which his stuff is really cool, really unique sounding. So I've got all the grayscale fonts on there for you, Jeff. And then we'll later on, I'll demo like the last few fonts, which are pretty cool. We'll probably do that with the blade effects because I did some really trick things with like Crystalline Workshop and you're like repairing your saber that Fernando actually helped me program a few extra things on how this saber works. So I'm gonna pause the video and then we're going to come back and do the next section of how to disassemble it and reassemble it. All right, be right back. All right, we are back for the next section of this video where we're going to go over just the last few fonts at the end of the font list. There are 50 fonts on here, Jeff, in total. I pretty much gave you most, if not all, of my freebie collection. So that's how it ended up being 50 fonts on here. And then, of course, you know, there's the ones at the beginning that we picked out and added to the saber. So this is the last grayscale font. And it's a red crystal, kind of like a Sith font type of thing. And so I wanted to show off the accent is doing something different on the inside of the accent LED. So I'm gonna turn it over. We're gonna get out our pointy tool and open the Bombay doors, the power gate reveal doors, like so. Yeah, see, they are really stuck together. There we go. One more try. They like to close up right away if you don't open them up. There we go. So here's the power gate. It's doing something different. We actually use the it was like the Cylon effect going back and forth, and then it speeds up when you power it up. So I wanted to show this off. Prion. So I love that. Close up again. I love that. You got blasters. Now it cycles, and now it's cycling back and forth. Clash. And again, you can change all these, customize them in either the vocal menu, which I'll show, or online on the USB interface. Lock up. So everything's just going crazy, including the crystal chamber. And power down. All right, so we're going to advance to the next font.
Calibrate.
And so Mad Cow's Calibrate is on here. And so one of the things I want to show off on the next font when the crystal's spinning, and this is another like repair your blade or your saber or your crystal chamber type of font. Lock up. And then, of course, Crystalline Workshop. I always like to customize this for, crystal builds.
Crystalline Workshop.
Power up.
Crystal Gore Timing Subroutine. User will attempt to manually adjust crystal timing anomaly caused by shock.
So one of the things that
correct problem,
or she's going to talk the whole time.
Function.
One of the things Jeff wanted to be able to see were the gears and the actual motor malfunction that due step to down.
Analyze and repair.
Hopefully that's focusing. You can just make out the gears.
Ready.
In there. And we we actually have the wrong crystal in here, so let's,
Monitoring energy. Core stability confirmed. Maintenance mode deactivated. Crystal core shielded. Goodbye.
So, of course, we have to swap it out to the right crystal, right? Back to Luke mode. Alright. There we go. So I wanted to show you guys what happens on Crystalline Workshop with the Prion. So here we go.
Crystal core timing subroutine. User will attempt to manually adjust core frequency. You may begin when ready. Welcome. Chassis disengaged. Crystal core exposed.
So the way I set it up is that you can take the Prion and wait for the crystal to activate until after she says welcome. So I thought that was kind of a cool trick I did with that. And so let me shut her down.
Stability confirmed. Maintenance mode deactivated. Crystal core shielded. Goodbye.
Such a great font. All right, so I'm gonna go to the next font. So this is Mad Cow's Thermal Detonator, and I did a really cool blade effect with this that I'll show when I do the blade effects, but this is pretty crazy stuff. Ears are ringing. Lock up. Such a cool font. And then...
Knights of the Old Republic, Holocron Meditation.
We gotta get our green crystal out of there, right? And put in the blue one. So this is your last font, Jeff. So when you're all done lightsabering or going into battle, you can come back and chill out to some Jedi Holocron meditation. So let's pull the green one out of here. We'll grab the blue one, and this will do it for the fonts. All right. Fire this one up manually.
The way of the light is long and difficult, as you must learn. Are you ready for such hardship?
So again, a Prion, and then it gets going. This is one of my favorite fonts, just because it's just so chill. And the blade effect I picked for this is super chill.
The lightsaber is the traditional weapon of our order. It is a symbol of a Jedi's skill, dedication, and authority. And each lightsaber is as individual as the Jedi wields it.
The font's perfect. The voiceover work in this is just some of the best I've ever heard.
Let it flow through you. Let the force fill the cracks in your spirit.
All right, and shut down.
May the force be with you in your quest.
All right, so let's start tearing this thing down and show you how it comes apart. It's a bit of a journey. So I'm going to take it out of reveal mode. Oh, nothing like a bunch of alarms going off while you're doing your video. Cool. So we're gonna go ahead and take it out of reveal mode. Get my glove back on here. All right. And we'll give you a close up real quick here. Of it, you know, not moving or anything, or on. You can maybe hear me talk. Okay, so let's go ahead and close it up. Now this does break down in a bunch of different pieces. So let's go ahead and take it out of reveal. And so, one of the things I like to do first, Jeff, when I'm taking it apart, is go ahead and unscrew the thin neck and the emitter. The same time, and then you can see in here we have pogo pins. I've done my TV screen trick again, where I've taken two layers of TV screen and glued them in there to protect this, so that when it's off it kind of looks like metal in there. And there's the front of the chassis. Here is your recessed pogo pin connector, and my buddy Master Mad Jack helped me mill this out on his lathe so that we could make that recessed so it's completely flat, just like that. And it also bought me a couple more millimeters to fit all this in here, because it was super snug trying to get it all to fit. So I'm gonna go over the emitter a little bit. This is your blade plug. It's just a tight friction fit. And so with the Korbanth LS6, as you know, you have to unscrew the emitter this direction. It comes apart, set it over here. It's such a cool emitter, like how the light shines through the back of this when it's activated. I love that setup. So here's your blade plug. Again, just a friction fit. Sometimes you can grab it and pull it right out, just like that. If you can't, you can use this tool right here and insert it just to support it. If it becomes difficult to come out, you just insert it in there and then kind of push it in and lift it out that way. But again, it's just a nice friction fit. Here's the blade plug with some epoxy in there to cover it all up, and then you get light around the blade plug. All right, so we'll set that over here. Put the emitter, or I'm sorry, the thin neck part of it over here. And then we'll go ahead and go over the control box. And what I've done, Jeff, we talked about this, is your clamp card is set up so that if you slide it this direction, like that, it reveals your USB recharge. So this is the only place you can recharge the Saber, you know, on the Saber, is in the control box with the control box attached. And so this will accept any type of micro USB. And I'm supplying this cable right here, which has like a very special magnetic end on the end of it. And we'll talk about that when I insert that into the USB interface on the Profi itself to get it into Profi workbench mode. But that's this piece right here, this micro USB connector, detaches magnetically from the end of that. And then it goes, you can use it here to recharge, and it has a full swivel on it when you put it in there. So I'll show that again later. Here's the swivel. So this is the end of it. And once it's plugged in, it does this. It completely swivels all around, which is nice, because if you bump it or something, you want to be, as I bump my camera, you want to be super careful. You want to be super careful that we never damage, you know, this USB port, taking things in and out of it. Because again, this is the only way to charge the Saber. Most of the time I like to like do one or two ways, but this one has a single. So when you slide the card the other direction, like this, then you are into where your switch is. This is your power switch here. Shout out to Ethan Zimmer. He helped me out a lot with kind of decoding the stock PCB card that comes with the Korbanth LS6, and showed me, you know, that I thought originally when I had this, that this pixel here was a NeoPixel. Turns out this is an actual red, green, blue miniature LED in here. And then this one is just a red one. And so he saved me a lot of multimetering time trying to figure out how to get these guys to work with the Profi and the programming with the wiring and stuff. And then, you know, I set up the switch to activate and deactivate the Saber. So like when we go in here with our tool, we can shut the switch off from here and turn it back on. All right. Then if you want to remove the chassis from the Saber, we'll go in here and we remove this plate. And then Jeff talked about how he wanted kind of like the green PCB that we see like in the cave scene and stuff when he's working on a Saber. So I came up with this, cut this out on my micromill. If you guys are cutting up PCBs or crystals, make sure you guys are wearing N99 masks. The stuff that comes off of these PCBs when you're grinding on them or sanding on them and or crystals is silica dust. And it gets in your lungs and it stays there forever. And it's not good if you get too much of it in your lungs. So caution, when you guys are doing this type of work, make sure you're wearing an N99 or don't even mess with this stuff. So that's my precaution to all you Jedi out there cutting up PCBs. Mundo. All right, buddy. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and shut it off now. Power down. I like to power down when we start disassembling things just because you never know, right? So here's the PCB in here that I cut away. Oh, and one of the things I forgot to show off, let me fire it back up, is Again, I did like a flashing police car light in here that flashes between red and blue. And one of the things that I loved about it that was a happy accident is you can see like around these holes, the blue actually kind of makes the holes look bigger and smaller as it's going from red to blue back and forth. I love that. I guess the blue goes through the PCB material and the red not so much. And so it has this kind of cool digital effect that was an accident. All right, so we'll shut that off. Okay, so next we're gonna get out our tool to remove the control box. And Jeff, you're gonna use three different size of these guys, Allen wrench heads for this screwdriver. And I'm gonna send you this kit right here. Brand new, in the mail. This should always take care of all of your Saber everything. This has every single size and star tools and everything else. And of course it had to be in Luke Skywalker green, right? So we take out the larger size and we're gonna put in the medium sized Allen right here. Okay. And then, so now that we have the top off of the control box, I like to go ahead and remove the speaker next. So a good way to look at assembly and disassembly of this is when you disassemble it, it's gonna be emitter first, and then control box second, and then speaker last. In the opposite direction, it's speaker first, control box second, emitter last. So we've taken apart, we've taken off the thin neck and the emitter already. So we're gonna take our medium sized tool, get in here, and you've got two steel screws that are custom steel screws that I shaved a length that actually go down into the, chassis. So once you put these screws in on the control box, the chassis will not move. I did that on purpose because you never want the pogo pins you're about to see to move forward and backward on, you know, where they seat, just so you don't avoid any shorts. I've never had that happen, but you do not want to move the chassis around in here until these screws are secure. And I'll show that on the reassembly. So let's take this other screw out. Okay. And there you go. Let's put this back on the cradle. And here is your control box. And then the screws are loose in there, you can see, right? So like when I push up on them, there they are. So let's flip it over. And I started making my own pogo pin connectors on the laser cutter. So it's an 8-pin pogo pin connector that handles everything from the red and green flashing arrows to recharge to the switches. So it needed 8 to do everything. And I use clear acrylic so that like when the crystal chamber and the accent LEDs are going back and forth, you're getting also extra lighting happening, you know, throughout the inside of the control box, which is kind of a cool effect. So there was that. And these are, you know, springy, of course, pogo pins that connect to the top of these connectors right here. There's 8 solder points in there that are connected to brass pins underneath that go down into the wiring throughout the Saber. And then now that the lights are off, nothing's going on inside, I'll let you guys check out the power gate part of it. Let's open it up. And this is what it looks like, you know, with the lights off, which there's your battery. And then these two pins right here, here and here are plus and minus coming right off the battery. And then there's an 18 pixel ring in here that does all of the effects for the accent part of it on the third channel. So if someone services this battery other than me, I always like to give instructions on the videos. Basically, you're going to remove 3 set screws in the end of the chassis that release the pogo pins for the speaker. And then I wanted to show this part now where you can literally grab these, unplug it here and unplug it here, and then the battery slides out the back of the chassis. You'd have to rewrap the battery in, you know, decorative tape, and then also reuse these pins, these custom pins that I shave to length that plug into like a female brass version just inside of the hilt here. And you'd reuse these on the next battery and solder them. All right, so let's close that up. And then next, we're gonna remove the speaker. So of course, unscrew the pommel. And then I wanted to show off the speaker setup that we have here. So Jeff already knows about this, but I'm basically sending him three different speakers. This is the TCS Wow speaker, which is speaker number one. And as far as like putting this pommel cap on, you wanna make sure that you don't over tighten this, Jeff. I actually blew a speaker because they're different thicknesses by about a millimeter or two. With the TCS Wow speaker, that's why I call it speaker number one, you can screw this all the way on until it stops, okay? Because that one's a little thinner than the other two. So then you're gonna unscrew this and you can swap out the different speakers. So all you have to do is grab the side of this speaker and see how the copper chassis on the inside grabs the sides of the speaker like this. And so you can just swap them out super easy. So you just pull on it from the sides. Of course, you never want to push on the end of it. Once you get it out, there's your Dimitri Stuck pogo pin connector, and there's the pogo pin connector in acrylic. These are the three set screws I was saying. If you remove this acrylic piece, you know, moves out of the way, and there's a long enough wire on there to where it completely moves out of the way, and then you can remove the battery through the back of the chassis. But these just swap out. The other two speakers, one of them I call the JAD speaker, which is speaker number two. That one is like a millimeter longer than this one. So when you put the pommel cap on, you'll notice a super tiny millimeter gap right there. You just screw it until it kind of snugs up and stops. Don't crank it down too hard because it can flex the housing of these speakers and damage them over time, okay? So this one, again, is the TCS Wow speaker. And then I'm going to mail your speakers in this container here, right? This one is number two, which is the JAD speaker. And then this is the Smuggler's Outpost 28 millimeter. They're all 28 millimeter base speakers and they all have the Dimitri pogo pin connectors on them. And this is the thickest of the speakers and the loudest. and so this is, you know, neither one of these, you just don't want to crank the pommel cap down all the way or you could damage them. So they're the other two that swap out. All right, we'll put the speaker over here out of the way. And now that everything is taken off, all the screws have been removed, we can come in here and grab the end of the copper chassis and it just pulls right out. Like this. And here we are. Here's your chassis, Jeff. And right now we got a blue crystal in there. And so one of the things you can do is take your skinny tool that I'm supplying, your tweezers, and you go in here and you just, there's a super tiny micro switch inside of here. Of course, I always like to make the chassis work outside of the saber. So we're gonna fire that up. We can put the speaker back in. Now that I've shown off how they remove and get reinstalled, put the speaker back in like that. And then this has twist activation on. There's your pogo pin connector. And of course, I went crazy with the micro mill. And this is just straight up copper plumbing tubing. I think it's 1 inch. It might be 1 inch copper plumbing tube. It's a long time ago that I bought it for this project. But I'll kind of cruise around and give you guys a 360 of all of this. And then you can also do blaster effects with a micro switch here, right here. My gloves are on. This is not gonna be an easy one to do, right?
All Jedi must know the code. Its tenets are the fundamental teachings of our order. Think and meditate on these truths, apprentice.
So this would be, you know, like blasters when it's activated and when you shut it down. May the force be with you. With twist off. So it's twist on to activate, twist off to deactivate. And then when you want to switch fonts, you hit your auxiliary button here. There is no power button when the chassis is in chassis display, you know, out of the hilt mode. It powers up with twist on and twist off. And then this is just your aux button right here. So let's advance to the next font. All right, let's advance to the next one. And ignition. So when you rotate, when you twist on and off, you're basically automatically putting it into battle mode by FET263. And so when you clash it, it's going to go into the battle mode clash. So anytime you use twist on, it's automatically going into battle mode. It does not do that when you use the buttons on the control box. Then it's in normal mode. So yeah, here we go. So you hit clash. And it won't go out of clash until you move it. I know you're familiar with this too, Jeff, because that's how your Obi-Wan's set up. All right. So let's deactivate. I'll flip it around and do a cruise through here. Of course, we have the emitter. This is a protector ring that I made so the pins can never get crushed. Aluminum. I did this on my micromill. Of course, you have all the micromill details. Set screws that hold the emitter into place. And right here, you can see these are my 20 gauge kind of large OFC speaker wires that I use throughout the build for maximum amps to the blade. And so I kind of wanted some wires to show on this because you figure like this is Luke's first saber that he built. So it would be kind of rudimentary showing some wires and, you know, that kind of stuff. Nothing. I just wanted it to like match the hilt where, you know, the hilt was kind of dirtied up. This was kind of dirtied up with aged copper. And again, lots of micromill work through here. So this is where all the wires run through, this braided line right here. And then we have our four pixels that are telling us to insert the color LED. And power gate, and then there's the battery all decorated out. And then we put various covers on the battery. And then down here in the speaker section. All right, and then to assemble, everything goes in the opposite direction. So we'll just do everything in reverse. So we're gonna use our tweezers because you always wanna make sure this is shut down before you reassemble it, Jeff. So power off on the micro switch. And then we're gonna take the speaker out because we don't wanna push on the back of the chassis with our thumb with the speaker in there. We want it out when we go to push it in. So we take the hilt, we line it up, and you see this notch right there? This has been keyed so that these eight connections, once you put it in here, they cannot move at all. So you see this pin right here, this set screw, this is raised for a reason. And that is because when you go to slide it in, you're going to line that up just like that. And then you wanna make sure that set screw is totally secure and flush in that U channel that we've made inside the body. And also we can reveal this part as well. Oh, I've got it screwed down pretty tight. But you can reveal it in this mode too. It's got screens and then the battery. So there's that, lock that back into place. Now this is where we put the speaker back in, which would be step one on assembly. So it's speaker step one, control box step two, emitter step three. So it's opposite from disassembly. So let's go ahead and put the speaker in. It just press fits into place, just like that. Then your pommel cap goes on. And again, this is the TCS, so you can screw this one down until it stops, all right? And it's secure. Next, we're going to reattach the control box. So here we go. And what you're gonna wanna do is set it into place, secure the middle of it with your thumb like this, just like that. Doesn't hurt anything to put your thumb on the PCB. Hold the saber like this, and then you're going to use your medium size tool, Allen head tool, and we're going to screw this one into place, snug it up. Don't have to go too tight, just kind of till it gets snug. Snug up that one and the other one. Okay, and then you can actually go ahead and fire it up from here. You can actually get in there with your fingernail. And fire it up in this mode, right? And so there is your stock connector, 5 pixel. And then you can go into reveal mode from here, like this. Easy peasy. And power down. And then you can go ahead and put the emitter back on. And with the emitter, you know, you just want to screw it down until it's snug. You don't want to crank on it too hard, Jeff. Just like that. Okay? And then here you can put your blade plug back in. Like that. And then screw on your emitter all the way. And power it up. And there it is. Blade plugs lighting up in green. All right, I'm gonna pause the video here and then come back and we will go over the USB interface. Be right back. And last thing I wanted to show off on the assembly disassembly that I didn't show before was the control box. You already know how this slides back and forth to reveal, recharge, and then power. But this is also magnetic, which is the way that it comes from Korbanth. But because I use steel screws, custom steel screws, to screw this control box down and stronger magnets in the bottom here, this is all held in nice and snug with the magnets to the tops of the black steel screws in there. And then I used the mill to get, you know, everything out of the way so nothing shorts out, and used once again fingernail polish to coat the inside of this top to bottom, both surfaces, all inside of here, and then also flow epoxy down in through the whole bottom of this so everything is rock solid. All the circuit cards, everything are never gonna move. So this is all permanent in there. And then fingernail polish on these surfaces that have been milled so that nothing can ever short out. So it's just real easy magnetic connection just like that. Yep. All right, so I'm going to show you, Jeff, how to prepare this for the blade now. And so you're gonna remove your emitter by unscrewing it this direction. And I actually like to do this with the emitter off. So, I mean, the thin neck off. So let's set that there. Let's go ahead and take the thin neck off. And I wanna show you, this is a lot easier to prepare it for your blade. Because Jeff and I were concerned about, you know, the LS6s are kind of famous for the blade wobbling in here because you don't get a lot of blade depth. And so here's a situation where the blade plug is really in there in this direction. Oh, there we go. I was able to pull it out with the gloves. And so what I did was, these are the stock retention screw holes here and here. You'll notice they're empty. All of the screws have to be out to use your blade plug because this is a one inch blade plug. So all the screws have to be out for this to go in and this to go over top and clear the screws, because if you back the screws out enough to slide this in here, then this won't go on. So once you pull this 1 inch blade plug out, what we're gonna do is put in a 7/8 inch adapter from 1 inch to 7/8 inch, which is this guy right here. So this is a custom piece that I made. Of course, Jeff, you can do your magical weathering on this, you know, with aluminum black or whatever it is you use so that it matches the saber if you want to. But you'll notice there's larger holes and then there's smaller holes. The larger holes line up with the larger holes here, and then the smaller holes line up with 440 set screws here. So there's 4 set screws total. So you get zero wiggle now on this at all. It's nice and secure. So what you're gonna do is take the 1-inch to 7/8-inch converter, slide it into place, make sure everything's all nice and lined up, and then you're gonna get out the tool that I'm gonna send you. And first we're gonna put in the larger of the set screw Allen heads, Allen tips, okay? And then I'm gonna send you the set screws in this little guy right here. You got four of them. And so we're gonna open this up. You can kind of dump these out anywhere. And so then we're gonna take our tool. Here we go again, trying to do this with gloves on. This is gonna be fun. So I can just snatch them up off the table like this. Grab the emitter. And so this is set screw number one. Is gonna go here. And just screw it in straight until it goes flush. See how that's flush like that? That way it's going into the aluminum, but not into the circle. So again, with the other large set screw. On the other side. Until it goes flush here. Just like that. So that way it's grabbing this now, even though this feels loose, it's grabbing this now and not allowing it to come out, but the set screws don't go inside of here and get in the way of your blade. If you go to insert your blade and it feels like it's not going down all the way, that's because these are in too far. Same with the 440 set screws. So we're gonna go from the largest tip and we're gonna change over to the smaller tip, which is for screwing in the 440 set screws. And these really bite into the blade. So what happens is these set screws go through past this piece and actually physically bite into the blade. This is a trick that Space Windu taught me. Space Windu from Civilized Sabers, of course, best blades ever. And so this was a trick that we kind of did with Daria's saber that worked out really well and we got no wiggle on his blade. So thank you, Space. Great idea. So that one, same, right? When it goes flush, you stop. Next one, same deal. Okay, I got that one on there. Go to the other side and the 440 screws into here until we get flush. Okay, now I'm gonna reach behind me and grab the blade. And Jeff, you already know you're gonna end up with two blades, a photonic green blade and a trans white blade. And so, again, I like to do this with this detached. This is so much easier to do it that way. So you go ahead and slide this into place. You just kind of barely wiggle it back and forth until you feel like it's hitting the pogo pins. Now that might feel like it's not going in all the way, which means I might have the set screws in. Too far, but let's just see, because I think the line, you can see a line on the blade, just to see if it's, you know, in all the way. So what I like to do is go ahead and start with the smaller ones because they bite harder, right? So then you're gonna go ahead and screw these in nice and snug and push down on it this direction with your fingers so it's pushing on the pogo pins. So we're gonna secure that. Flip it over, do the same thing on the opposite side. And then before we tighten the large ones, let's make sure we got the blade in all the way. So let me just screw this into place on the saber itself, like this, and just snug it up. And let's activate the saber. We have ignition. All right, cool. So then you can go in and tighten the other ones. So let's take our larger Allen head, switch it over in the wrench, the screwdriver, and then snug these up as well, just like this. Give them a good snug, that way they bite into the blade. just like that. And then you take your emitter and you slide it all the way down the bled. Screw this on, and there you go. We have ignition. Photonic green ignition.
Revert.
All right, so I'm going to pause the video again here, and then we'll move on next to probably the blade demos now that we got the blade in, and then last we'll do like the USB interface using workbench mode. All right, be right back. All right, guys, I want to come in and do a saber stand edit with the lights off so you guys can see how this thing operates from top to bottom. What I used for the LED lights in this are car, like interior car LEDs that they sell online. It's like a square NeoPixel setup, and there's two of them in there. And so they can be controlled separately if you kind of use the remote control and point it in different directions. And so what I like about this is like it cycles through the color modes not evenly, because there's a split down the middle, and there's like a left square of NeoPixels and a right square of NeoPixels. Also, this is powered by a 2.1 millimeter jack in the back. And at the other end of this, you can't see it, but there is a 12 volt step up converter, because it's technically supposed to be driven by a car battery. But because USB is 5 volts, when you plug in the step up converter, it steps the voltage from 5 volts to 12 volts. So the other end of this that's plugged in will actually use with any, you can actually use with any type of USB connector. Now, Jeff, what I've noticed is that the lights seem to work a little better if you use kind of one of your more powerful USB wall plugins that you would use in Singapore. So I like to say, you know, anything at or above 2 amps, it's gonna make these lights, you know, work a lot better. If you get below 1 amp, it might start glitching and doing some strange things. So that's it. Here is the remote control for it, for you, Master Jeff. And yeah, so, you know, it's got all your controls. You can do red, green, blue, white. And so also there's an increase and decrease on brightness. And what I've noticed is because it's having to step the voltage from 5 volts to 12 volts, that part of it can be a little underpowered. But it was the only way I could find to power these car lights, and they only make like the car style ones in squares. So if you turn up the brightness, which I'm doing right now with the up arrow, you see it getting brighter, and you see how it's starting to flicker. You can see that on camera. That shows you that it might be a little bit too bright. And so then you can turn it down until it kind of steadies itself on the white setting right there. Maybe you can't pick it up on camera, but now I'm seeing it steady in person. So then, we can go through other colors. We have oranges all the way up to the yellow scale. Then we get into your blues, purples. And then we have over here, we have what they call flash, which just kind of flashes through the colors. And if you notice, after a while, the colors go out of sync, you know, because of the two different halves. So that's kind of cool. And then the next one is strobe, which is kind of my favorite because it kind of strobes different colors, like almost like yellows and blues back and forth between the two sides. And then the next one is fade. And so that's gonna cycle through the colors. And then you'll start to see they go out of sync because you've got the left side and right side differences. And so then the last thing on here is smooth. And so I don't know how smooth it is, but that's kind of what it does. It cycles between the two. There you go. That's smooth mode. So then you'll see those also go out of sync because of the two different NeoPixel like wafers in there. So that pretty much covers a stand. All right, guys, we have arrived at the blade demo section of this long marathon movie-like video. I'm trying something a little different here. I'm gonna video in the garage, the blade effects. And so right now,
We are on font zero, which is the font that doesn't allow any crystal chamber light to bleed through on that crack in the hilt, you know, that's kind of there by Korbanth type of thing. So I'm going to go ahead and advance to font number two, which is going to be the Luke cave scene. And then we're going to run through your Luke fonts, which would be fonts 1-14. So we use the rotoscope effect from FET263's website. I love the original trilogy way that this looks. And so, clashes. Blaster. So you see that in blue. Lock up. And then also twist off. And we'll go to the next font.
I'm Luke Skywalker.
Twist on. And these are pretty much like very similar blades through all of the 14 first fonts. Pretty much all I did was use color change to fit the different characters. So Luke green, Vader red, and so on. And Sidious red. So yeah, pretty much the same type of thing. Blue blasters. What I was thinking was anytime it absorbs like an energy weapon, like blasters or Sidious's lightning, this is what it does. So that's going to be lock up. Yep. All right, power down. Next font.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
And I use different shades of the green. So you have more of like a true green on the first two, and this is like a yellow green. And these are reactive. Depending on how you hold it. Alright. And now we're in battle mode. And then when you pull it away, it stops. I believe. Next one, speeder bike. So this is its own separate blade style for all the vehicle type fonts. Whoop, accidentally hit mute. Let's try that again. There we go. I love these have some swing bright effects. Localize lockup. And this saber's crazy loud. I don't know if it's got something to do with the stainless steel construction on this thing, but man, it's like the speaker pot in here is just crazy loud. I only have it on 1500, which is half of the amplifier power, because once I go above that, it's almost too much. Next.
There is no conflict.
Alright, Veda. Oh yeah. Beautiful crimson-y looking stuff. And then this is something that like we went in and customized on the bench mode and gave it like a white flash on clash, white lock up, and then blasters show up in blue. All right, next font. Another Vader.
Now his failure is complete.
So it's gonna be pretty much the same thing. Good stuff. Next.
If you will not turn to the dark side,
another Luke Skywalker font. Let's run through these quickly.
Skywalker, ROTJ.
This is more like the yellow-green mix. All
Skywalker. I have been expecting.
Now you will experience the full power of the dark side.
I love that. Freon's so cool. The volume menu comes on sometimes when you double-click power in the up position.
I'm looking forward to completing your training.
This is my font.
In time, you will call.
Where I kind of just edited some things around to do like a Luke versus Sidious type of font.
You will find that Creon. It is you who are mistaken. Give in to your name. Give in to your name.
And we have stab.
The
white flash on flash.
Let the heat flow through you.
And then a lockup sample.
Your overconfidence is your weakness.
It is your destiny.
And power down.
Good.
And here we are on my font, Aquaforce. And so I did like try to do like an underwater green blade that uses like water droplet effects on the inside, and then of course swing bright. Lock up. Blue blasters. And power down. Alright, this next font is by Jesse Kirkwright. I believe these are two of the freebies on his website, which is Battle 1 and Battle 2. So here we go. No swing bright effects on this one. Blasters. Oh, that's a nice lockup in red. Yep. And shutdown. This is Battle 2. Nice purple. Blasters. Next. This is my font X-Wing.
This R2 unit of your seats has been beat up. You want a new one? Not on your life. That little droid and I have been through a lot together.
So again, Prions. With fire or X-Wing. And then we have lock up. Death Star approach. And lots of quotes from the trench scene. Clashes. Blasters sound like they're straight from the old X-Wing game. And power down. Alright, next font.
Force is strong in my family.
This is Fonts by Force, and so I kind of like changed some boots and stuff around and turned it into a Leia font. Leia blue. Lock up.
Lightsaber.
Next font, we're on to Yoda's lightsaber. This cracks me up every time.
Obi-Wan, cut your beard, you must. Reshaped looking? The shaver of a Jedi Knight, this is.
So there you go, silly one.
What a piece of junk.
This is piece of junk, which is like a training remote. I'm sorry, this is Millennium Falcon, piece of junk. There's just too many fonts on here. With 50 of them, I'm getting confused. So let me show that off again. Here's Shutdown. So this is one that FET263 programmed for the Millennium Falcon coming out of hyperspace. Let me do that again. This is so cool. So you can use the pull-downs just to make this happen. And on his site, FET263.com is amazing. Yeah, hyperspace mode. Gotta love it. We have yellow blasters. And Shutdown. So sick what you can do nowadays. All right, next font. All right, so this is the training remote font. It looks so real, rotoscoping. It's like. It's amazing. All right, next font.
Loki religions and ancient weapons are no match for a good blaster at your side, kid.
You don't believe in the Force,
so I call this Flying Blind. This is my training remote font, and I made it more of like a white, like it is in the original trilogy. Back when Star Wars was on VHS, right?
Yep. What if he doesn't survive?
So this is the Boba Fett font that like FET263 also set up another thing where you're like dropping bombs. So this is pretty incredible. I love this. Yeah, it's amazing. Swing bright, of course, on this font. Really cool. So this is the one that I was talking about earlier in the video where you can't hear it until you swing it, but I added all the Wilhelm screams when you swing. So you're just like taking out baddies left and right. There you go. And I think that does it right up until we get to the grayscale fonts. And so I'm gonna go ahead and pause the video, fast forward, and then we're going to do a couple of the grayscale fonts at the end that have some cool prions. And then I'll pick it up again and end the font list. Okay, be right back. Okay, I'm just gonna demo a couple of the cooler fonts by grayscale fonts. Again, you can go download these for free at grayscalefonts.com. What I love about this font in particular is that if you just activate prion effects on your blade on sounds like this that have longer prions, this is what it'll do. So all you have to do is activate it in the pull down menus on FET263's website. All right, here we go. Insane. Of course, his fonts are just crazy. The dubstep of fonts, right? So I had to showcase that off. All right, so then we're gonna fast forward towards the end. And we'll show off this random one. So these are energy blades, Jeff. So this is a different program showing off the energy blades. Of course, lots of swing bright in these. It That looks nuts. That's so cool. We'll go through a few more.
Mercenary.
So many fonts. Grayscale. Another one, Prion. Oh, I hit the power button again. Let's do it again. There we go. Settles into red. So this is like the flash bright when it first powers up, and then it has like swing bright. So cool. See it move.
Calibrate.
So this is Mad Cow's Calibrate. And it looks pretty much the same as Crystalline Workshop. So I'm just gonna go ahead and go to Crystalline Workshop.
Crystalline Workshop.
And so this is something that I use one of FET263's blades styles. And made it so that when you're in Crystalline Workshop and you're pretending that, say, you're repairing your saber, let's say the plasma isn't coming out of your blade properly. So I set it up so that you can actually repair it, and then it stays repaired permanently until you reboot the saber. So let me fire it up.
Crystal core timing subroutine. User will attempt to manually adjust core frequency. You may begin when ready.
This uses the metal forge. It goes out, and then...
Welcome. Chassis disengaged. Crystal core exposed. Repair and maintenance mode operational.
And now...
Core stability at 93.138%.
So you gotta keep talking. Now you're in blade repair mode. So what's cool about this is when you're using the ForeSync app on this effect, let's say you had this on your workbench on your table, and you, every time you hit clash on the ForeSync or clash it manually, it's going to repair a segment of your blade. So here we go.
Timing circuits misaligned due to impact.
I must have hit it twice because it repaired two sections of the blade. So here we go, once.
Timing circuits misaligned due to impact.
Halfway.
Malfunction on regulator A14 at induction coil. Replace immediately.
Past halfway?
Crystal timing anomaly caused by shock. Analyze and correct problem, or use auto calibration function.
Three more to go.
Failure detected at magna conduit THX1138. Pap. Timing circuits misaligned due to impact. Recalibrate.
One more.
Crystal timing anomaly caused by shock. Analyze and correct problem, or use auto calibration function.
So now that your blade is completely repaired, you can power it down.
Core stability confirmed. Maintenance mode deactivated. Crystal core shielded. Goodbye.
So when we go power it up the next time.
Crystal core timing subroutine. User will attempt to manually adjust core frequency. You may begin when ready.
And you'll notice...
Welcome.
Blade is totally repaired. And of course it's got all the blasters.
Failed.
Clash sound still.
Regulate. Auto calibration. Mount preparing to replace or repair.
It's such a cool font. And power down.
Resistor. Goodbye.
And what's cool is, like, I kind of recently discovered this. When you use twist on, it bypasses the preon. So if you don't want to hear the preon, you just use twist on like that, and it went right into welcome and into repair mode. Whereas if I hit the power button, it goes through the entire sequence. So again, if you use twist on, it bypasses the preon and won't play it. All right, next. So I love this. This is Mad Cow's Thermal Detonator. I just had to try it on a saber. This is so cool. So I added FET2 one of his styles on here as well. It's like a flamethrower type of thing. So I don't know. It's kind of like lobbing bombs to me is how I'm looking at it. And depending on how hard you throw it is how far it goes. and you have to wait for it to recharge. So this is so cool. I love this. And then it's almost practically a dark blade, so the effects show up really cool on this. You hear the ears ringing. Just amazing. Alright, power down. And then the last font, when you're all done fighting, doing all the stuff you gotta do to stay alive as a Jedi, right? We take you to...
Knights of the Old Republic, Holocron Meditation.
And this is definitely in my top three favorite fonts. Again, the voiceover work on this is amazing. So here we go.
Close your eyes.
And so what I added, and hopefully you can catch that on camera, is the smoke blade. So it's just like a blue smoke blade, like, you know, you're meditating in front of a Jedi holocron. Super chill, and just very relaxing.
The dark side is not simply giving in to anger, temptation, or to use the force to destructive ends. These things only lead to the dark side. Emotional entanglements can be dangerous. They can impair rational thought. They can lead to outbursts of uncontrolled emotion. A Jedi must be above such things.
So this is your lockup.
There is no emotion. There is peace. There is no ignorance. There is knowledge. There is no passion. There is serenity. There is no chaos. There is harmony. There is no death. There is the Force.
It's just an incredible font. Very unique. I love unique fonts. I'm so much into the outside-the-box stuff. All right, and power down.
May the Force be with you.
And then it takes us back to... Font 1. All right, that is going to conclude the blade demo here in the garage. All right, guys. All right, Master Jeff. So one more thing I wanted to show you is when you get towards the end of this video, you're going to get to the portion where it talks about workbench mode and how we can go into workbench mode and change all the different colors and aspects of the blades. And like blade effects like clash and blaster. So what I wanted to show you real quick is demo for your particular saber, the vocal menu or edit mode setup for your saber. And so everything that you can do in edit mode on the computer, you can also do in vocal, like live vocal edit mode on the saber while it's activated. So you can kind of do, you know, you do it this way manually, or you can go onto the computer and use workbench mode. So let me power this up, and I want to show you, like, this is a red blade, right? And when we do blasters, we're getting blue blade effects. But when we do clash, see how we're not really seeing much of anything on the blade at all? Well, that's because the clash is set to red as well. So if you wanted to fix that, like, right now without having to hook it up to the computer or anything, you would go into edit mode. So with the saber powered off, you would basically press your thumb against the aux and the main power on button at the same time and hold it until
edit mode.
Now we're in edit mode, okay? So we can rotate the saber.
Exit.
And it's going to give us different menu
delete
options.
Preset. Copy preset. Edit settings.
So we want to go into edit settings, I think.
Edit track.
Let me keep going.
Edit font. Edit color.
Nope. Edit color. So because we're trying to change that clash color and the lockup color to something other than red. So we're going to select that with the power button.
Select blade.
So now it's going to ask us select blade. And this is where, like, your saber is different because basically it's using, in a way, six different channels for all the different effects that happen in this saber.
Six.
So if we rotate one. Clockwise, it'll go to one. It'll say one. And one is your crystal chamber.
Two
is your the accent LED disc on the inside.
Three
is the main blade. So when you know you're making changes to the main blade, it'll do this and flash. If you go to four, this four now, that is going to be one of your green arrow.
Five.
Your red arrow.
Six.
And the crystal chamber motor. So
one,
those last three you
six.
Do not want to mess with. You want to leave those alone. So we're going to go back to three where
five,
it's flashing.
Four. Three.
All right. So that's three. That's selecting the main blade. We're going to click power.
Color menu.
And it's taking us into the color menu.
Reset colors. Copy colors. color options, preset colors, copy colors, color options.
You want to go into color options?
Select effect, swing color, stab color.
Let's go the other way.
Swing color, base color, blast color, clash color.
Okay, there's clash color. I'm going to select clash color, and we want to set the clash to something that'll stand out from red.
Select option, color list.
We want to select the color list, so hit power again.
Red, orange, red, dark orange.
And it'll give you kind of a preview.
Orange, gold, yellow.
So let's select yellow because we know that's going to stand up.
Yellow.
Stand out against the red.
Save color options.
So now there, that's save that. Now we're going to go back a menu.
Cancel, select effect.
We're going to select a different effect.
Lockup color.
Now let's say the lockup color we want to change because that's not showing up either on the red blade. So we're going to hit power.
Select option. Color list.
Color list we want, so select, hit power again.
Red, orange, red, dark orange, orange, gold, yellow, green, aquamarine, cyan, deep sky blue, dodger blue.
Let's make it dodger blue, so we're going to lock it in by hitting power.
Save color options.
So now that's saved it. Now to back out completely, we're going to hit and hold auxiliary.
Cancel main menu.
And then we're going to hit auxiliary again.
Exit.
So now we exit. Now when we go to do clash, see how it's yellow. Exactly what we selected. So then lockup should be blue. There we go. And so that's pretty much how you edit your colors on the blade. Let's say, Jeff, you find a color that's not showing up against the other color. You have multiple reds in there for the effects. You just go in with the edit mode vocal menu and change it all. Now, another thing I want to talk to you about real quick is I did not set any battery level modes on this. The reason that I did that is because if you activate the vocal menus, I've had this happen where I've actually been woken up in the middle of the night by leaving the saber on, and it woke me up by saying, you know, low battery, battery, I forget what it says. But I did not activate that on this saber because it's kind of nice to be able to leave this saber on display, you know, have your arrows blinking or your crystal chamber glowing or something. With the power plugged in, you can have the power plugged in all the time. Have the saber on in idle mode. Now you don't wanna like activate the blade and leave it on, you know, for a long time just sitting there on the stand because the charger can't keep up, you know, to charge the battery as fast as it's being drained with the blade. But if you wanna put the saber on the stand, turn power on, plug in the USB charger and just have it sitting there chilling with all the accent lighting and stuff doing, you know, cool things, you can do that. And the reason I turned off low battery mode is so that if you don't have the USB plugged in and you just want to display it for a while without the cable plugged in and the control box top on, that way you're not going to, you know, all of a sudden just hear like an annoying low battery type of thing. The way you can tell on this saber is if the battery's getting low is that it'll just start to do really weird things. Your speaker's gonna all of a sudden get really crackly. Even the red and green flashing lights in here will start to like flash really dim or not flash at all. And that lets you know that there's just not enough power to run the programming on the board. So you'll get little clues that it's, you know, kind of starting to mess up. So that pretty much covers everything with edit mode and also your how to tell if the power is getting low and it needs to be recharged. All right.
Okay, in this segment of the video, I'm gonna go over some of the custom things that I did on the programming for Jeff's saber when it comes to like the color wheel and color change. And then we're also going to show how to connect, actually install the USB adapter for USB connection for power bench mode. So, one of the things I wanna go over is the unique customization when it comes to color change. So basically the way I understand it, and hopefully Fernando, I'm not butchering this, is when we go into color change, it uses like kind of the standard color wheel with vocal sounds and everything, But because in OS 6, they wanted to come up with workbench mode, it now uses base colors. And so what happens when you go into color change and base colors, if you have multiple channels running on your lightsaber, like say in this instance, Crystal Chamber is on subblade 1, the accent LED is on subblade 2, and then the blade is on subblade 3. So what normally would happen if I hadn't customized anything is when you go into color change, the blade would, or the crystal chamber would mirror the blade, and the accent LED would then also start to mirror, no matter what you did in here, would start to mirror, you know, all three would be the same color. So what I wanted to do, Jeff, was kind of make it act like the way it used to in the color wheel setup. So when you go into color change, it actually does something different on the accent LED versus being mirrored to the other two, if that makes sense. So basically the way I set it up was so that when you're in your first 13 fonts, you know, kind of like the Luke Skywalker theme fonts, this will never mirror the other two to in idle mode. So see how this is blue, then we have green, and then a green blade. So let me demo this and I'll fire it up and show you what I mean when we go into color change. So power on, it settles into a red. And then color change, you just click and hold aux and power at the same time. Like that. And so temporarily, it's gonna show that it's mirrored. All three colors are the same. And then we start white, scrolling through the color wheel.
Red.
Right?
Orange red. Dark orange. Orange. Gold. Yellow. Green yellow. Green. Aquamarine.
So let's say we stop on aquamarine and we set it into that color. Now you'll notice once I do that, then the accent LED is going to do its own independent thing. All the other fonts except for the first 13, 14 fonts with the Luke Skywalker stuff, it's going to mirror. But you can go in after the fact and change it in OS workbench mode. So let's say we want to go back to green, which is what the color was for this Luke Skywalker font.
White, red, orange red, dark orange, orange, gold, yellow, green yellow, green.
And then we want to lock in that green and we just click and hold power real quick. And then it takes us back to where we were before. So this was something that Fernando helped me on the color wheel set up. And thank you, Fernando, because this is pretty cool. I like that, you know, sort of the themed fonts for Luke work this way so that we get different colors in the accent versus all three being the same. But again, once you go into workbench mode, which I'm going to show how to connect that next after setting up the USB interface, you can go in and customize all of these colors. And so that just kind of covers that. So what I like to do before I start messing around with inserting the USB interface into the Profi is, of course, shut the saber off. We're going to be moving some metal parts around up close to the Profi. We don't want anything to short out. So we're going to go ahead and kill the power on this like that. And then, of course, we got to take out our green crystal. Yep. And put it over on the stand over here. Okay, now that that's out of the way, you can see we've bought a nice amount of space in there. And so, let's set this down. And this is the swivel USB connection I was talking about right here. So the only way to be able to pull this off, to be able to make this interface with Profi after it was inside the chassis, and you can do this with the chassis outside of the hilt, or do it right, you know, through the hilt while the chassis is inside the hilt. So this little connector right here is magnetic, and this is a data connector. So you see you've got these little rings on here and little pogo pins, and this will not only supply power and data as well. So one of the things I wanted to show you, Jeff, is to charge it, you can actually take this little USB connector right here, and if you've got it on display, and let's say you just want to leave it on power on mode all the time, just chilling in idle mode, and you can do that, doesn't hurt anything. We plug this into the top here, where the charge port is, like that. And then this just magnetically connects to the top of it like that. And you know, you can charge it this way. What's nice is because this swivels, there's less of a chance of this getting damaged if it got bumped or anything. So there, you can use this same data cable to also charge the saber through here. But what we're gonna do is hook it up to USB on the Profi itself. So I would grab this one, since this is easier to grab it with. I'm sorry. We're gonna use anything metal. So like the kit that I'm sending you, or any tweezers, the kit that I'm sending you has like a steel pair of tweezers in here, right here. And so these guys right here, you can do the same thing I'm gonna do with this metal wrench. And so what I like to do is take this part of it, and because it's magnetic, I can just put it on the end of this. Make sure, I like to call it smiley face up on the micro USB. See how it looks like it's smiley face up in that direction at like a 45 degree angle. So like this. And then you're gonna ever so carefully come in here and put it inside the crystal chamber. And then we're gonna put this in the front of the Profi. My thumb's in the way. Let's see if we can do this like that. It's a little tricky until trying to do it on camera. So this is not easy. Go in here and you're gonna use the magnetic part of it and see how I've got it propped right inside the Profi port. And then all you do is give it a gentle push and it'll pop right into the USB port on the Profi. And there you go. That's how you get it in there. And so then we take this part of it, the USB magnetic, put it at a 90 degree like this, and then you're gonna put it in there and it's literally just gonna stick and connect straight to the USB. Now, when I go to plug it into the computer, you'll see it light up, and this is how you'll connect it to Profi workbench mode. Now see how the speaker sounds all crackly? That's because we haven't applied battery power. So it's just using the low voltage 5 volts or, you know, amps coming off of the laptop. So your speaker's gonna sound crackly because that's the only thing supplying power to the Profi. If you want it to sound clear, which you would want to in workbench mode, you can go ahead and now turn on the power. So let's get out our tool, kick on the power, and then when we cycle, we're nice and clear again, okay? So in reverse, when you're done using workbench mode, and I'm gonna show that in the next video, what you would do is turn off the power. Okay, after you've done all your programming in workbench mode, then you're gonna unplug this from the laptop. Then you just gently pull this cable out because then it magnetically breaks away. And then you're gonna use your skinnier tool. So say, not this one, because this is a little bit trickier to get in that, you know, over the top of the USB port. You're gonna use this one, and we're just gonna go in here and gently, you don't even need to squeeze or anything, just kind of push it in front of it like that and pull it out, just like that. What's gonna happen is it's gonna probably fly out of there, stick to the crystal chamber holder magnet, and then you just go in here and gently pull it out like that. Okay, and then you're ready to go again and put your crystal back in. All right, so that shows how to install and uninstall the USB interface for the Profi. And then we'll go into how to interface it with the laptop and USB workbench mode. Okay. All right, so here we are on the final section of the video where we're going to show how to use your particular saber, Jeff, in bench mode. And so what you would do on your PC or otherwise is you would go to FET263.com. You can see it right here. Of course, FETT263.com. So once you get here, you're going to look at all of these tabs on the right side, and then you're going to go into edit mode for Profi OS 6. And then you scroll down just a little bit, and in the middle, you have Profi OS Workbench. You're gonna click on that, and it's gonna ask you if you wanna connect via USB or Bluetooth. We want USB since it's a faster connection. And because I've had this saber hooked up before, normally when I click USB, a little window will pop up right here. And then you'll have to, you know, click on Profi board and say, okay, you know, or connect. So we're just going to go USB, and then it's going to automatically populate everything. Okay. And so here is all of your presets. So I should probably explain the rotating crystal chamber thing again, because I added preset one with the lights out right here. So I did that because when the main body section is closed up down here, you know how we were getting a little bit of light bleeding through from the crystal chamber? Well, it's kind of a last minute thought. I was thinking, well, I'll just add the same exact font as the Luke cave scene, which Luke cave scene is preset one and preset two, only preset one has the lights off. So if you want to display it with the power on, you know, or use it with the power on and not have the crystal chamber lighting bleed through that little, you know, crack right here in the body section, you can select preset one. So we click on preset two, loads the same font, but now it has, you know, the crystal chamber and the accent lighting doing what we want it to. So I think when I said before, font number four would have been where like the speeder bike, where the crystal rotates. It turns out because I added this as preset one with the lights out, preset five is now going to be the speeder bike font. So we'll click on that. So see, there's the speeder bike font. That's the one where when you power on the crystal, the saber, the crystal rotates all the time. So then this would be not rotate all the time, six, seven, and eight. And then once you get to nine, the crystal rotates again. So every fourth font, you know, it alternates back and forth between crystal all the time, crystal not rotating all the time. Okay, so let's get back to preset two. And so here's all of your tracks that are in the tracks folder. And so you can just kind of play these from this, you know, however you want.
The Jedi are romanticized, deified.
Okay. If you strip away, and so then to stop the track, you just click over here on stop track. And so you can also control the saber with these controls here, which is on, which is nice. Clash, which is nice because when you're going through and changing the colors of everything, and I'll show you how to do that, you can preview it this way. So, blast, force, lock up, chip drag, melt, and you have to click on it again to stop it, stab, and then lightning. Okay, and you can see how everything's reacting. So then we go to off. Then up here in the upper right-hand corner, we have a bunch of other different controls. So if you click on this little pencil looking thing, it sends you into color edit mode. All right, Jeff, I wanted to come in here and do a quick edit because I realized I didn't explain after watching the video back a couple of things. The biggest one on far as the way to connect it is you can use Bluetooth. When we get here and we click on Profi OS Workbench and it gives you the choices of USB or Bluetooth, you can use Bluetooth as long as you have like a newer kind of faster PC. This works really well on Barbara's PC because the Bluetooth is like a newer generation Bluetooth, but this does have the Feezy Bluetooth chip in it. So you can use Bluetooth and then you won't even have to go through the process of hooking up the USB cable to the Profi. So I wanted to point that out, that you can use the Bluetooth on your Saber, and it will work pretty fast as long as you have like kind of a newer, faster PC is what I've noticed. It was giving me problems on my newer Mac because I have a Mac M1 chip, and so the Bluetooth was just doing strange things. But again, on Barbara's PC, it worked great. So if you got a PC, I would try this first before going through and hooking up, going through the process of connecting the USB cable. So this is just wireless. So you get in here and try that. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and re-click on the USB. It's gonna take us back in. And then, as long as it populates everything fairly quickly, here we go. Let's go ahead and go over to, well, we're gonna switch over to preset two. So we pick up where we left off after this edit. All right. And then we're going to go into the pencil or your color change settings again. Okay, good. It populated everything really well and quickly this time. So I wanted to go over kind of what happens with the crystal chamber. So style one is going to control all your colors for the crystal chamber. Style two is going to control that 16 pixel disc accent LED disc in there that's inside the Bombay doors right here. And then style three is, of course, going to be your main blade, your blade. So going back to the crystal chamber, right now, you know, we're on font two, which is a Luke font. So the base color is, of course, set to green. If you want to go in and make color changes to the crystal chamber, I would probably leave this one alone because this is your base color. And we always want that base color to mirror the blade so that it asks you for the right color crystal in this color. So I would not touch this color right here, but it's fine to go ahead and mess with all these. So like if you want your crystal chamber, say on ignition to kind of flash red, you would click here, go into the red part of the spectrum, right through, you can use your color wheel in here, go to the red part of the spectrum, click off of it. And then it's gonna, when you hear the boot sound, that lets you know that it actually saved and took the change. So let's say in blast color, we wanna do something in blue. So you would click here, go into your blue spectrum change, click in the blue area and then click off of it. And now blast color is gonna do that. Now let's make lockup color white just for fun. Click off of it. Okay. And so then when we go back over here to test out our changes in the crystal chamber, we'll click on the pencil again. And that takes us over to here. Now watch the crystal chamber this time when we power it on. Instead of doing yellow, it should do red. Here we go. Now see? And then it's gonna settle back into green. So if we do clash, I don't think we changed that. Blast is now blue instead of yellow. And then lockup should be white. There you go. So there, that's kind of how you control the crystal chamber part of it. Now, when we go back over to the pencil or color edit mode and we come down to these other two, what I wanted to explain in better detail is kind of what Fernando worked with me on. Basically, what we've done with this color right here, the base color on the accent, is Fernando walked me through how to insert the old color wheel, the way that, you know, the previous and like OS 5, the old color wheel used to work, where if you insert the old color wheel code in this position only on the base color, what it does is the colors rotate out of sync from the crystal chamber and the main blade. So I kind of want to just make it easy for your Luke Skywalker fonts at the beginning to always have a different color on the always have a different color on the accent LED, if that makes sense. So when you get down into your other fonts after your Luke Skywalker fonts, it's going to act normally. So basically, like the way it works is, because of that, Fernando said, if I want to do that and add that old color wheel into the base color, it's not going to show the correct color in workbench mode. So for instance, this is green right now, okay? And you'll see, let me flip this over and open up the Bombay doors again. Okay, let's get out the pointy tool. And then you can see in here, use my fingernail this time. You can see that it's blue. So your base color here shows green, but you can see, you know, on the accent LED, it's actually blue. So those are the only ones that are not gonna match. There's only two colors. And so what I've done is made like a quick color chart for you. And if you wanna take a screenshot of this right there,
screenshot it now while you're watching this. That's what it's going to translate to. So see how it shows, you know, like green equals blue here on the third line. So that's why, you know, it's green on the screen right now, but then blue in the accent LED. So this is the only one that's not going to match up, because I wanted to make that third color, you know, that color in the accent always different from the blade in the crystal chamber and your first 14 fonts. So if we go in here, same thing with the crystal chamber. If we go in here, and let's say right now, you know, this is blue, we know that when we go into blast color, it's not gonna be that drastic of a difference when we go into blast because this is also blue. So let me change this, say, to white. So when we go into blaster, now the accent is gonna do white. In clash, let's make it something different. Let's go into yellow. So it kind of stands out from the blue, okay? All right, and then off color, we can do the same thing. We'll come over here and let's make it yellow again, okay? All right, so then we go back to test it. You'll see that it took the changes. Turn it on. Fires up, settles into a red. Clash is now yellow. Blast is white, like we made it. And then lockup, that stayed red. And that's it. Whoops, let's turn that off and go back over. So that's kind of what I wanted to explain on the edit. Kind of the gist of it is that this color right here is the only color that is not gonna match what's on the screen. Just so we always have a different color on the accent when you're in your first 13 fonts. That was just to make it easier for you and kind of make the Saber work the way it used to in OS 5 that we're all kind of used to. Because once you go into color change on all of your other fonts and even on the first 13, it's kind of complicated because once you go into color change, it's going to erase what you've done and it's going to sync up those three channels all the same color until you go into this, you know, workbench mode and change it manually. Once you go into color edit mode, it's going to kind of forget some of the things that you've done in here and go back to using the base colors all, you know, on the three different sub blades. So I know that's kind of complicated. I hope that makes sense. If you have any questions, you let me know. All right, so this is the end of the edit. You have more settings over here in all the way in the right corner with the settings gear tab. Of course, you probably want your brightness on 100% all the time. I've noticed that on some of the bassier fonts that when it was sitting on the stand for the first time, it's actually been triggering some of the sound. So I'm actually gonna take this up to 4.0 and it'll probably stop doing that. So here's your clash threshold. I've now bumped it from 3 to 4. Your blade length on your crystal chamber accent pixel strip, the 1515, is 4 of those tiny pixels, the ones that's showing you which direction to insert the crystal. You probably never want to mess with these because you've got 4 in the crystal chamber. You don't want to mess with those. 16 is on blade 2, which is the accent circular LED in there. You have your main blade length, which is blade 3 at 117. And then these control like the red arrow, the green arrow, and the crystal chamber motor. So I would not mess with these on any of the fonts. There's really no need to. And then you can, of course, activate and deactivate your gesture ignition, your swing ignition, your swing on speed, all these cool different things in here. You can turn on, turn off, twist on, and try some of the other gesture ignition and power off settings. So yeah, that kind of covers that. You can watch FET263's and May the Sith, Tom's video to see like in a super in-depth detail what you can do with this program. And it all works online. It's pretty cool. I mean, obviously I got the USB plugged in and into the USB interface on the Profi and then into the computer. But the interface is an online thing, which is really handy. You don't have to download anything. You go straight to this web page. All right. So I think that pretty much covers it, guys. I am going to go ahead and sign off here. End the video and may the Force be with you. And may the 4th be with you. And may the 5th be with you. Take care. Jedi Arms Dealer is out.